say, if two quick announcements. If you are someone that you feel that could kind of add variety to my panel in the future, please come see me afterwards. I've been having, these happen to be good people that I know, but I would love to have all kinds of people that are on there. Specifically, people have asked for women. Like, why are there no women on their panel?
And the women don't actually read comics.
And so,
it's like, you know,
I'm not funny, but, you know, I happen to know the people that I know. So, you know, if you want to please come after, that's how I found London. Who knows everything Batman, so that's how I found her.
I've never met this woman in my life.
so we did it. And so my name again is Jessica. I do the comic book girl and littlegeekgirls.com and Girl on Geek. So those are my sites. And actually, these guys are way more important. So so I'm gonna go with them. Adam, Pavic, how are you?
I'm great. Thank you guys for being here. It's my first Stanley Comic Con panel. This is pretty cool. Thank you for having me.
Please say which Superman you are representing, and you believe he is the best.
I have Henry Cavill Superman.
Aww.
We'll see. We'll see.
I noticed how he did not then give any reason as to why.
Any reasons?
Hector,
give
me up. Be real good buddies.
You got it. Hi, everybody. My name is Hector Ibarro. Thank you as well for having me on this panel. I'm representing modern comic book Superman, which I think is 1985-ish to now, somewhere there.
I told him, Michael, you got to take U52 and Rebirth, son. Like, you just
Good stuff. Good.
Hello, I am Mukwaman Orocha. I am the host of Comics on Comics, and I am defending Christopher Reeve today. Oh, yeah, I know. And here's the thing, and I won't, like, previous Batman, like, the Battle of Robins, the person who got Dick Grayson was basically just like, Dick Grayson, right? And, you know, but I can assure you, I will put a actual defense and tell you why my Superman is clearly the superior one.
You also have Brandon Routh, and it was because Superman Returns was a sequel homage.
I didn't know that you were going to weigh me down like that. Fine.
Now let's see how you do.
With that deficit, I will be even better, and I will show you.
Interesting. My name is Zach Massetta. I'm a film and TV review person. I have a website you can check out, Zach for Real. I'm going to be representing Dean Cain from the Lois and Clark.
Look at all these wrong people. Oh, and you know what? There's an audio delay. Yes, okay, that's what it was. They heard me say this movie, and they.
You've been on too many podcasts.
Elliot Magan, and I'm representing the Bronze Age Superman, the comic guy. Largely the one that wrote.
Oh, okay.
You are a force to be reckoned with because if you can see in the front, he's the father who coined the term Last Son of Krypton, which is in DC continuity and is the title of our panel.
Right, which also means
LexCorp. I just want to point
that out.
LexCorp.
So we can literally say anything and it's now continuity.
This panel is canon. Hi, I'm Joe McCabe. I'm the West Coast editor for SFX magazine, reporter for The Nerdist, and the author of this book, 100 Things Superman Fans Should Know and Do Before They Die, which just came out this year. And I'm representing the Silver Age Superman. Also, by the way, I just want to point out how honored I am to be on the panel with Elliot Magan. I'm not just kissing ass. It's, you know, to paraphrase Raiders of the Lost Ark, most of us here are just chronicling history. This man is history.
Right, so, absolutely.
And I feel like if you got a stamp of approval from Mark Waid with Kingdom Come that Hector brought, then you've really got merit.
Yeah. You've done a thing or two.
Also, an exclusive interview with
everyone. Didn't I write the forward in that?
Let's see.
Oh, God, we're about to bust out.
Introduction by a Elliot S. Nagan. Great. So you know a thing or two.
All right. That's fine. Oh God! Yeah. All
right. Also has exclusive interviews with everyone from Noel Neal to Melissa Benoist. So just pointing that out. If you need a copy, you can find me after the show.
I am Jim Thompson. I taught Superman comics for Duke University for 15 years. I am also a super family lawyer. If anybody has any divorce questions, I'm available for consultation. The question is, why, and I'm the Golden Age Superman and the George Reeves Adventure of Superman, Adventures of Superman. Can I say why mine is the best? Can we, I mean...
If you want to start with me,
I was going to say, for those who remember him from last year and that London was on our panel, he, because he's a lawyer and also another force to reckon with, he pulled out a yellow legal pad with facts, and I heard like the silence on the panelists got all real quiet.
But so now that, you know, I'm sure you guys have all been in school, so now, like, when a professor keeps droning on and on and you just, like, check out, that's, that'll probably happen a few times.
Is anyone going to represent Krypton?
He's got the professor over there.
Yeah. There are some Supermen.
And you're the nanny?
The RA?
We have some Supermans that unfortunately can't be represented for various reasons. Tom Welling was more of a before. We love Tom Welling. But with Tyler Hodgman, we need to have more episodes. Just various things. If you have a question, ask me afterwards. John Schnapp could not be here. He had to leave early. He was going to represent the animated Superman, which is Tim Daly and George Newbern. And he was the guy behind the documentary, The Death of Superman Lives, Whatever Happened, with Nicolas Cage and Tim Burton. He's a great expert as well. Hector, if you would like to shoulder that burden, you can also pull out quotes from here, because he's more modern times.
Great.
we were down the panelists, but that kind of gives us a little bit more time of a talk. So, although it is who is the true last son of Krypton, to make it more fun, it's more of who is the best Superman, who is your Superman, you know, or my Superman. And from there, because, you know, there's only so much we know about Krypton. And so some of the questions, I would love the fact that everyone here is prepared with facts and storylines and quotes as opposed to just, because you're stupid. I've never been on those kind of debates. And so I'm really excited. I'm kind of really what they have to say. And so let the fun and also educational schooling come from these guys. And so it's more of, I felt bad because people were like, Jim has said, are we specifically talking about being the last son of Krypton? And I was thinking that'd be too niche. We kind of make it more broad about why you think he's the best, especially in terms of what you imagine Superman to embody, all the qualities and all of the traits. That, I'll let you guys stew on that one, because that one's going to be the big question that kind of ends it. We're going to start with more of the happier, good, fun ones. And if you guys have any questions, there will be questions available, time at the end for you guys to ask them. The first things first, behind every Superman is a Lois Lane.
Or Wonder Woman.
Or more Wonder Woman. Why? So, I want you guys to pick a specific incident, whether it's a plot, storyline, event, moment, that you feel like this is why Clark Superman is with this woman. And this is why my Lois Lane is the best reiteration of the fearless reporter and wife to Superman. Look at them. Well, none of them saw these questions beforehand. So none of these people saw these questions beforehand.
Are we going, what direction are we going?
Yeah, do you want to start from the end? And move,
you know what, we'll start with Jim and work our way up to, all right, to Adam.
Most perfect, Lois, say it again, please.
The most perfect, it could be in words, either an event, a moment, a plot, a specific thing she said, in which you feel this is why my Lois Lane is the best. This is why she's the fearless reporter that this man has chosen to be with.
Okay. Well, I mean, to be honest, it's hard with the Golden Age, because I love that Lois, but she calls Clark Kent a worm most of the time. You miserable worm. I mean, she's more brutal than I think any of the others may be. So since I'm doing double duty, I think I would opt for season one Adventures of Superman. Maybe it's the most perfect Lois Lane in relation to that.
Phyllis?
Huh?
Phyllis?
Yes.
Okay.
You think?
No, I like Noelle.
I see. If it comes down to that, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Between the two, I thought Phyllis Coates was hard-edged and believable as a reporter. And Noelle did the Wedding of Superman episode, and that may be the best, so I understand why you would say that. But the season one Phyllis Coates version of Lois Lane is, I think, the most believable reporter out of the bunch. On the Golden Age comic, I would say there's segments where she gets demoted back to the like the lovelorn column. So it's a little tricky there. But at the same time, this is my favorite moment. In terms of the comics, Clark has an invitation to go and get an exclusive interview. Lois says, you know, I'm sorry I've been treating you so badly. I want to have dinner with you. Let's have a date. Clark is all excited. Lois then puts something in his drink to knock him out. Actually, supposedly to knock him unconscious so she can get the interview instead. Of course, it doesn't work because, you know, Clark pretends to be knocked out and then goes and humiliates Lois. That's actually my favorite Superman and Lois moment, is the drugging him. As a divorce lawyer, I just... I've known wives that drug their husband every night so they don't have to talk to them. That, it reminded me of that. That's my cynical view on that. Oh, yeah.
Okay, so I guess that I'm defending the Silver Age Lois, which is pretty closely aligned with the Adventures of Superman TV show Lois, especially because they share the same DNA, and Mort Weisinger, who was story editor on the Adventures of Superman TV show, and then the editor of the Superman line in the Silver Age. The thing about the Silver Age Lois is that kind of, I think she had the greatest influence on young women that the previous Lois might not have had. Although the previous Lois, the Golden Age Lois, or, you know, E.B. Phillips Coates first season, I guess you'd say, was kind of that hard-nosed, you know, His Girl Friday reporter. The Silver Age Lois was the one who I think had the most exposure. I know that when I was interviewing Dana Delaney for my book, she was talking all about how that was her Lois. That was the one that she worshipped growing up, just because she showed that you could be a single professional woman with a career and, you know, break the glass ceiling and do all those things. And that was a revelation for her as a little girl growing up in a conservative home. And then as far as stories go, there's not so much any one individual story because there's so many of them. And by the way, most of them, the thing that distinguishes them primarily from the Golden Age Lois is that involves the concept of Lois trying to prove that Clark is Superman, which nicely aligns with the fact that she's a reporter. She should be trying to prove that. And you know, of all those stories, the one that actually sticks out the most in my memory is not even really about Lois, it's about Lori Lemeris. It's her first story, The Girl from Superman's Past, because it's like a heartbreaking story, and at the end of it, Clark is just kind of like devastated as he's thinking about this. And the mere fact that Lois is sitting there kind of makes everything okay. You know, like she's the one thing that can heal Superman's broken heart. And it reminds me of that scene in the end of the Gwen Stacy saga in Spider-Man where MJ is there for Peter, and it's like, you know, she shuts the door, she refuses to walk out, she's going to be there for him. It almost seems like Lois unwittingly is proven to be there for Clark in that moment. So, anyway.
Like in a couple of incidents in the Bronze Age period, there was this comic story in the early 70s, I think it was 72, called Gorilla Grodd's Grandstand Play. And at the end of this story, well, I used to tell people, I killed off Superman 5 times in the course of 15 years and I never got a press release. this was the first time, and it was clear that Superman was dead. Grodd had had wiped him out, and Lois at some point decides she's going to comfort herself with Clark, and Clark is going to tell her everything's going to be fine. And when the hoax of the thing comes out, and Superman comes out and vanquishes Grodd, in the last scene of the story, Clark goes to see Lois in her office, and he says, you know, we said a lot of things when we thought Superman was dead. I hope you meant some of that stuff. And she says, oh no, Clark, you know, my heart belongs to only one man, and you just can't measure up. And he walks out of the room, well, if that's the way you want it, Lois, and walks down the hall, and the door is closed behind him, and as he's about halfway down the hall, he bursts out laughing. That's their relationship. That's the triangle. But when it became no longer a triangle, when they were clearly a couple, it was a scene I wrote in this book that Jim has, the Kingdom Come novel, which Mark alluded to in the comic book, but I kind of wrote it out as the death of Lois Lane. About 10 years after they got married, at some point he's gone. He's on another planet on a mission or something. And the thing about Lois is that she had no fear. And Superman could perceive that. And he consciously perceived it, because he could smell fear coming off of somebody's lungs like a trip hammer. And he never detected it in her under any circumstance. She could be falling out a window. She wasn't afraid of anything. It wasn't that the pheromone was missing, it's just she didn't use it. So at some point, she sacrifices her life to get the Joker, to keep the Joker from killing everybody at the Daily Planet. Pulls out a window, grabs onto him, and they both go down, and Superman comes back from his mission, and Lois is gone. And he finds solace in the arms of Wonder Woman, which is, I guess, fate. Okay? You're next.
Should you say fate or fate?
Fate.
It is.
Zach Lois's name is in the title of the show.
It is. And Terry Hatcher is the best Lois Lane yet portrayed on screen. She has the spunk and the looks to play the character. If you can get over the fact that Lois Lane, investigative reporter, cannot tell that Clark Kent and Superman are the same person, she's great. A specific moment is hard because I genuinely feel like the relationship between Lois and Clark is built up so well and very gradually over the show. I think that the fact that she agrees to marry Clark without knowing that he is Superman is probably her greatest moment. Because she's in love with Superman, of course, don't get me wrong, but you know, she's able to see that she probably has more in common with Clark than the Man of Steel.
When were you going to tell me when the children start to fly?
Well, the funny thing is, we come back, this is the season finale of season 2, we come back to season 3 and she has already been told. She's just like, why didn't you tell me before? So we don't get to see him tell her, unfortunately.
All right. So why is Margot Kidder the best Lois Lane? I'll get to her. So Margot Kidder was an actual strong woman. And I believe that Superman's strength comes from the people who help him. And Lois Lane is his rock. You know, Lois is able to, my Lois has what I believe she was given 3 Pulitzer Prizes by the time Kate Bosworth rolls into town. And when Superman then takes off, right, at the end of whatever would be Superman 2 and the Brandon Ralph would be Superman 3, she then goes off and finds somebody else. She's like, look, I've got a kid and I need to raise it. And, you know, she was strong enough to say, you know what, yes, you're Superman and that's cool, but I also need to live my own life and raise my children. And she had that strength of character to realize that, you know what, it is my son who's more important than the Superman. And that is why, you know, and then, of course, we go Margot Kidder to Kate Bosworth. So, hey, who doesn't want a wife that gets younger? All right. And you want to speak?
So I have modern-day Superman comic books. I was also given an animated series stuff. And my favorite thing about Lois in that era is that she was, in an effort to continually update Superman, I think we all up here, we love Lois Lane, but it is really tough to get to swallow that pill of, like, she doesn't know that Clark's Superman. That's really tough. So fortunately, after 85, in the comic books, Lois and Clark started dating and got married, and that was a huge deal. Superman and Lois were some of the only long-standing comic book characters that were allowed to evolve in that way, which is really great. She was there when he died, and she's had a ton of great moments. The animated series, Dana Delaney is a pitch-perfect Lois. She's fantastic. The really exciting thing about what's happening in comic books now, here's going to be my moment for what I love that they're doing with Lois Lane right now, if you guys aren't happening to be reading it, in the DC Rebirth title, specifically Superman, which is fantastic. Action Comics is fun. Superman is great. Right before that, they did something called Superman, Lois, and Clark. This was his miniseries written by Dan Jurgens. It was fantastic. Here's what happened. Because it's a new universe, comic books are confusing, right? It's a brand new alternate reality. So what they have done, DC Comics has said that the original Superman from 85, from after Crisis on Infinite Earths, the one that married Lois Lane, the one that died and came back to life when he fought Doomsday, survived this other universe. And him and Lois popped over into this world, and they had a kid. And they named the kid Jonathan because that's what they would name their son. And they decided to, while this version of Superman, let's say he's around 35, 40 years old, they decided to lay low because there's another younger, sexier Superman who's like 25, and he doesn't have red underwear anymore, and they're letting this guy do his thing. And that was the New 52 that happened in 2011. But the entire time they said this older, wiser Superman who's been through stuff is there, and they're deciding to lay low and protect their son, protect their family. And there's a bunch of great Lois moments in that, because Lois and Clark here are a modern couple, and they have discussions about what they're going to do with their family and what's best for them and for their son, and they love each other and they care about each other. And Lois, because she is a writer, and that's what she does, she's not just the wife of Superman or the girlfriend of Superman. She writes under an alias to make money, to help the family, to help the income. You know, because Superman's not going to use his powers to make a bunch of money. That's not who Clark is. He's going to help people, and they take a fake last name, and Lois is doing that, but it's not enough. And again, also in this world, if there's a younger, sexier Superman, there's also a younger Lois Lane who's running around, and she's doing her thing. At some point, she dies or something. We don't know. She's gone. And this older Lois with a son decides, I'm going to basically steal my own younger person's identity. I'm going to walk up to the Daily Planet. I'm going to be Lois Lane reporter. I'm going to get a job because it's what I do, because it's what I love to do. And Clark is like, totally, 100%, I've got your back. And that's the Lois that I love. And they're doing really great, exciting stuff with their son, which is great. And we get to see Lois evolve into this character, into another completely new facet of her character. And I think that I kind of have, this is going to be my running theme, guys. I have kind of the unfair advantage of having modern-day comic book Superman, because I feel like it sort of incorporates the best of all worlds, of all versions of Superman. And because continuity is a tricky, fickle thing, modern comic book creators can decide what works and what doesn't, and we can just talk about the great stuff. So that's what's happening with Lois and Clark right now, and that's why modern Superman, and even this new bearded one, where he doesn't have a beard anymore, is the best, modern comics.
So I have Amy Adams, Lois Lane. And the thing that I actually really, really do like about this Lois Lane is, first and foremost, she's a go-getter. She will not stop until she gets what she wants out of whatever story. And they did make her finally made Lois Lane the woman who knows that he's Superman and Clark Kent and Kal-El, and it's not that big of a deal. I feel like in the other versions, it was always such a huge revelation, a big thing, because she was so in love with this one character, this Superman character that she built up in her mind to be this big thing. And in this, it's more about, it's not really so much about exposing this character, but it's really getting to understand who this character is, how his psychology works, why has he been hiding for 30 plus years, you know, where has he been this whole time? And there's a thing that she says to him that I really like. It's when they're at the gravesite, and Superman finally reveals himself for the first time, and he flies through space and stuff, and she meets him at the gravesite after she's done all this investigative reporting of figuring out that there is this guy who's been going around Earth, he's somehow connected to this spaceship, this whole incident. And she kind of is able to put all this stuff together. And she says to him, I figured if I turned over enough stones, you'd eventually find me. Where are you from? What are you doing here? Let me tell your story. And Clark says to her, but what if I don't want my story told? And he said, and she says, it's going to come out eventually. Somebody's going to get a photograph or figure out where you live. Well, then I'll just disappear again. And her response that I love is, the only way you can disappear for good is to stop helping people altogether. And I sense that's not an option for you. So I think that that Lois Lane, they gave her that mindset of to not treat this character as a threat from the immediate point where we meet him. And I think it kind of builds a different type of personality for Lois Lane, whereas she's not just an investigative reporter, but she also is able to put aside kind of what the general perception of this character is and to treat him as a human being. Whereas I feel like before, not in all iterations, but in various iterations, he'd always just kind of been looked up to as this god. And I like the fact that she treated him more as a human, a fellow man of Earth, and really just want to understand who he was and why he was hiding, what he was afraid of, to kind of justify being a part of his life.
So, and, you know, I'm going to start with Adam and go kind of the way down. I want to make sure we be able to kind of end on time, assuming it'll end at 4, but if it's after 4, that would be great too. So we'll try to, I'll try to not make questions that are just so open-ended and so broad. So I apologize. I know, like, if we could have this, it could be on for 3-4 hours.
Mm-hmm.
But
I think it's easy for everybody up here to talk about Superman.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it is. Yeah.
We're going to be here until midnight, right?
Yeah. We're going to be here until midnight. So, and we're going to start with Adam, because I think this question pertains more to you. We're going to move all our way down. Pick a moment where Superman does something that seems out of character, out of very Superman-ish, did something crappy, but yet you can still defend him and say, no, he's still a Superman.
Has anybody seen the first two Superman movies in the DC Extended Universe? That's, to me, honestly, like, that's the one interesting thing about this Superman, the one that exists in the DC Extended Universe, is I think we always go into these movies or these comics or these TV shows with a perception of he's Superman from day one. That's kind of always been the running theme in all these iterations. He's always Superman. And the thing that I kind of like about the Superman, the thing that, for me, humanizes the character a little bit, is the fact that he isn't that big blue Boy Scout. He's not exactly that perfect iteration of the Man of Steel that we've come to know and love for 75 years at that point when Man of Steel came out. But I mean, I think there are plenty of things that he does in, especially Man of Steel, that he suffers the consequences of in the next movie. And a lot of that is taking for granted the aspect of actually defending humanity from threats like General Zod, like Feor, like the whole Kryptonian army. So I think that's a huge thing that everyone really points out, that definitely makes him less Superman. But I think it's also a part of a huge building block of why he eventually will become that character.
Ooh, boy, I like my Superman a lot. I'm going to pick a moment from Kingdom Come, which was, to me, when I read this in my youth, it really informed a lot of who this character was, and I kind of use it as a comparison chart every time we're talking about Superman. And there's a specific moment that happens at the end, but I think that a lot of Clark's motivations and his actions in this future, you know, version where there's no more supervillains and all the young kids and children and successors to superpowers have kind of run amok. I think he makes a lot of decisions. I mean, he creates a prison, and it's in the shape of the Legion of Doom headquarters, and this, you're like, what is Superman doing? But he thinks he's doing the right thing. At the end of the story, when everything goes bad, and a lot of what he thinks, a lot of his closest loved ones, his best friends, the people that are still around in his life, die because of a nuclear bomb that humans launched, all these superpower characters because they're afraid. He goes to the UN and starts wrecking house, and he starts destroying it. And he's got red in his eyes, that great, you know, the laser vision, deep vision is about to pop up. And the spirit of Norman McKay with the Spectre go to talk to him, and he's holding these pillars, and he says to him, Norman McKay says to him, you're letting in that anger, you're forgetting once more what humans feel, that they feel fear. You won't forgive, they won't forgive you for this, Clark, forgive yourself. And there's this great shot where he lets the pillars go and starts talking to Norman McKay. Norman McKay lays it out perfectly. He tells him, your greatest superpower has always been your instinctive knowledge of right and wrong. This is, to me, a moment that is very human that Clark goes through, which is everybody he loved just died. Everybody. And earlier in Kingdom Come, a beautiful flashback, my favorite thing about Superman, this version of Superman, the modern version, is that in the flashbacks we learned that Lois Lane was killed by the Joker. Lois Lane was killed. And instead of Superman going evil and turning into a version from Injustice the video game, or a Justice Lord from an animated series, or this alternate version Zack Snyder concept where he's going to turn completely evil and work for Darkseid, he decides, I'm going to arrest the guy who killed a bunch of people. I'm going to arrest the guy who just killed the love of my life. I need to arrest the Joker. Magog shows up, the 90s Arnold Schwarzenegger, Punisher, Cable character, and kills Magog, and everybody, the public, sides with him because they're saying, we want this type of character. We want somebody who enacts justice. We want somebody to finish the job. And Superman then decides, well, then I'm done. And that, to me, is what Superman is. It's somebody who, even if he loses everybody, he will continue to do the right thing and continue to protect human life because it is precious, because it is so rare, because it is valuable. And at the end of Kingdom Come, when he loses his anger because everybody dies and just starts destroying the United Nations, it takes the spirit of an old man, played by Alex Ross's father, to tell him, calm down, this isn't who you are. And that's why I, of course, forgive him. It's great drama. Forgive him for that moment. So.
All right, so we have Superman 1, 2, and then Brandon Routh is 3. So Superman 4, or yeah, 3 and 4 of the previous series did not happen, so we'll just skip the fact that Superman went back in time after, well, how am I supposed to fit in Brandon Routh, right? So I can't, right? So instead, I will defend Brandon Routh, Superman the Stalker.
That's why they started 5 years after he left the planet.
Yeah.
They didn't want him to have dealt with 9/11, for example.
Mm-hmm. Right. You know, so what they did was he leaves for whatever reason, and then he comes back. And, you know, when he's gone, he comes back, and, you know, Lois has a kid, and we have the super emo Superman who's just moping around, using his X-ray vision to look in through the house and everything. And, you know, you have to realize, this is a Superman who, for the first time in his life, really, is experiencing loss. So he goes off to his destroyed planet of Krypton. He sees that there is nothing there. And then he makes his way back. And when he makes his way back, he's probably hoping, hey, you know what? Life will go on. I'll be with Lois. And, you know, life will move on happily ever after. He comes back, and that is not the case. He no longer has Lois. So now, for the first time in his life, he has loss, and he doesn't know how to deal with it. Here is a Superman who can leap tall buildings in a single bound, and he's got a broken heart, and he doesn't know how to deal with that. And how does he deal with the way most guys will deal with, which is, well, you know, I'm sure she still loves me, and if I show up and show her, then clearly she will be on my side. Turns out that doesn't work. Because, you know, women like to be told, hey, you're cool, you're awesome. And women also like it when you don't leave. I don't know why, but apparently women like that, that you're around. And Superman is trying to deal with this. Superman is trying to become a man, right? And through the course of that third movie, he becomes more of a man. He becomes less super and more of a man. And yes, you know, you should probably have gotten a restraining order against him, but, you know, there isn't much you can do. And, you know, he then learns, hey, you know what? It's okay that she went on with her life. It's okay. And, you know, he becomes, I believe, a stronger person because of it.
You know, it's really hard to think of one of a moment in Lois and Clark because maybe it was partly because of 90s television, but they go out of their way to make him, like, always the good guy. I mean, they have reasons and explanations for, like, there's one point where Lois is about to marry Lex Luthor, and he's like, hey, if that's how you feel, you know, go for it. There is one episode where there's a Red Kryptonite episode, obviously, and even then, it's not like he's a jerk. He just, like, doesn't care. You know, like, there's someone about to get run over. He's like, eh, whatever. So anything that's, something that's not Superman-ish, to me, his ability to maintain these two separate identities was terrible. It's like, you know, He'd say, I got to go do this thing. And then he'd walk out of frame and then immediately hear Superman coming in. Or Lois Lane would say, man, I wish I could let Superman know how I feel. And he'd be like, I think he knows. You know, just like that sort of stuff. So I just felt like he could have done a bit better job, you know, maintaining the separation of his identities. But, I mean, he is, in this show, he is such a Boy Scout. I mean, it's really hard to come up with a specific moment that he wasn't sort of inhabiting Superman. Even though they do go through the whole him, you know, dealing with these superpowers, understanding how to fit them into his normal life and still be a good, you know, superhero and everything, we, the audience, know that he's a good guy. And so that's kind of how it's written.
Well, I think Superman does things out of character every day.
That's what the relationship between Superman and Clark is about. I keep talking to people who claim that Clark is the real person and Superman's a construct. It's clearly the opposite. Superman is the consciousness of this guy. But Superman needs Clark because Clark can do stuff Superman can't do. Clark doesn't need Superman. Clark has a life. He's a real person. He's got everything together, except he's kind of a goofball. But we had this character named Steve Lomborg, and they're still using the name, and they're still using the character, but it's a different character now. And in every issue, Carrie Bates and I, we used to make up a Steve Lomborg bit. As a kind of comic relief, he would come on to some woman, embarrass Clark in public, and his pants would fall down. You know, that sort of thing. Superman can't do that. That would make him a bully. But if Clark does it, even if Clark does it secretly using his superpowers, it's okay. Because he's kind of, because Steve is kind of a jerk. In ancient mythology, in all mythology, including contemporary American mythology, the hero is the character's best self. But there are other manifestations of the hero. Odysseus came back to Ithaca disguised as this beggar. And the only one who recognized him was his dog, Argos. He was like a 20-year-old dog, put his head up, barked, and died. And eventually he revealed himself to be the real person behind this beggar by displaying his superpowers. He was an incredible archer and he showed that off. King Arthur, the same thing. He was king from the day he was born, but nobody knew that, not even he did. And his real identity came out. He didn't even have to hark back to that wart character that T.H. White called him, or any of the other manifestations of this nerd that he had been before he realized he was the king. Moses, the same way. He was a prince of Egypt, but what he really was a surrogate for God. Well, that's higher. That's better. And Superman is from the same tradition. He does things out of character all the time because it's in his character to do that. It's kind of necessary for his psychological health.
That's an amazing answer. Joe and Jim, guess I've been patiently waiting. Okay.
This kind of relates to what these gentlemen were just talking about. But yeah, in the Silver Age, Superman had this code of ethics that he lived by, which to a certain extent he still does. Don't lie, don't kill anyone, help other people when you can. But he broke that code every day because he lied about, you know, who he was. He pretended, you know, he had this secret identity. And, you know, but we forgive him for it because, you know, it's that idea that he's, as a sort of god, he's doing it for a greater good. You know, you're not supposed to kill, but if you're in battle, you know, whatever, or self-defense. So, you know, that lie was, you know, the one sort of, you know, chink in the moral code armor, if you will. But, yeah, we would forgive for it every day. And then, of course, you could say, I guess, rationalize that he's not lying because he views himself as being both Clark Kent and Superman, but, you know. And that goes back to the fact that the Silver Age was where it really emphasized that Lois was always trying to prove Superman was Clark Kent. So that was, you know, that kept coming up time and again, that, you know, was really thrown in the face of the reader, the fact that he was just lying to her every second of the day.
Many of the other panelists are, I think, mired with the slogan, truth, justice, in the American way.
Yes.
Very happy to say that mine isn't. That the very first, because truth is what? It's subjective. Justice, what is it? It's in the eye of the beholder. The very first issue of Superman, first page, identifies him, his mission statement, as champion of the oppressed, the physical marvel who had sworn to devote his existence to helping those in need. Champion of the oppressed, helping those in need. Not truth, not justice, those are concepts. These are actual people. Later, the first page often calls him the savior of the helpless and oppressed. That's what I love about the Golden Age Superman. So that brings me to action number 8, which is the most interesting of that early first year or two. Superman becomes enamored with a young group of juvenile delinquents who are caught doing illegal things. He actually breaks one of them out of the police van. Then, in consultation with them, he realizes that they're bad, but the reason they're bad is because of their environment, because they're growing up in slums. He looks at a newspaper headline where Florida has been devastated by a hurricane and the government is rebuilding it. So what he does is he goes into the slum areas and he starts just tearing it down. He starts terrorizing the police, the agencies, everybody. They can't stop Superman. They send in the Air Force and they bomb the crap out of and destroy the entire area. The government then has to build low-income housing, brand new buildings for these juvenile delinquents, thereby giving them a chance. That's Superman. It's also just wrong as crap, I mean, in terms of doing that. But that's his greatest moment in some ways for me. By doing that wrong, he is doing his mission statement, which is the seed of the oppressed and the needy. That's it.
So we can talk about his powers all day long. Usually when it comes to kids, they're like, why do you like him? Like, he can fly, he's strong, and then we can talk about the powers he has or didn't have or has been retconned, all kinds of stuff. But let us talk about really, you know, I mean, I don't know how we're doing on time. So, but I guess not too brief, but briefly, but enough to say, what is a moment that outside of this bundle of superpowers, he was the most Superman and he saved the day or a life simply by his wits and his words? Anybody can go for this one. So
I'll go first. My Superman, yes, he does a lot of stuff, but there's one thing that my Superman has that most don't, and that is a smile. You know, in Superman 1, he saves a cat, right, from a tree, and he's about to fly off, and then the little girl says, hey, what is Superman? And Superman just turns back with a little smile, waves, and then flies off. And, you know, non-verbally, that smile is... You know, the hug, the smile is your father's love, you know. That smile is perhaps one of the most important superpowers that Superman has, because he can immediately comfort you, and you know what? Yes, the world is literally falling apart around me, but this man can save me. This man can help me now. And that is Superman, who is not doing anything, you know, except he's just doing it all with a little smile. And that is why I think that is an amazing superpower that is not a superpower.
I got one. Modern Comics All-Star Superman, Grant Morrison. There's a moment where Superman does not need superpowers. It's something that we can all do that has been shared. I'm sure you guys have seen memes and images, and there is a young woman who is on the edge of a building. She's contemplating suicide. Superman shows up. And he's just there, and he says, you're stronger than you think. And this image has been shared by people who have had suicidal thoughts. They have shared stories that moment has gotten them through so much. And even though All-Star Superman is this beautiful homage to Silver Age wackiness and zaniness, it has a very grounded character at the center of it. And that is something that Superman, especially modern comics of Superman, continue to say, that Superman's greatest powers are not his abilities, but rather that he can inspire people to just do what you can with what you have. He happens to come from a planet where gravity works differently, so he's awesome. But it's just do what you can with what you've got, and that's a beautiful Superman moment that's just hard, no powers.
And kind of piggybacking on what they had said, the Lois and Lane show is very quaint. It's very small. So a lot of the danger is, you know, there's a lot of people falling out of windows, people about to get run over, and that sort of thing. So he doesn't really do a lot of big scale stuff. However, there is one episode where Lex Luthor has created a clone of Superman, who is not Bizarro, unfortunately. But he is out, because it's necessitated by the script, the world has to see this. So he's doing things like saving crashing planes, you know, like bigger scale stuff. So anyway, eventually Superman has to track him down, of course. And the entire time, like, Lex has been building this guy up to believe in violence, and whoever's the strongest survives and everything. And Superman is able to connect to him by showing him empathy, which he had never seen before, and is able to kind of show him the power of emotions, which sounds silly, but it was a really memorable part of the show.
I want to go back to this smile thing.
No, really.
I always tell people that Superman stories are not about power. They're about moral and ethical choices. And that somebody asked me once, if there were a real Superman in the real world, what would he do? I think he'd start a comic book series based on this character. Because you really can't not kill anyone. You really can't not be complete, not lie ever. There was a scene in Hollywood Land. Remember?
Mm-hmm.
Great movie. Has Ben Affleck.
Huh? Ben
Affleck. Yeah, Ben Affleck
was in it. Ben Affleck played George Reeves.
This is my guy.
Your guy. Mm-hmm. I love George Reeves. I gotta tell you.
He's the best smile.
Yeah, he never stops smiling.
Second best, absolutely.
Yeah, you know the girl that plays Gordon's new girlfriend, Vicki Vale's mother or aunt or something? Valerie Vale in Gotham. She never stops smiling. I mean, she can call somebody names and she'll go, you know, like that. I'm trying to grow that smile. I'm trying to grow George's smile. Superman is a guy who should enjoy being himself. I should get off on it. That's why I like the new kid, Tyler Hoechlin. He specifically plays it differently from
Henry Cavill,
who I like as an actor, but he's not Superman. He's somebody else. And he's Henry VIII's sidekick. That's who he is. But he's not
Henry VIII's sidekick.
Yeah, you remember? Yeah, the tutors.
Yeah.
Henry VIII's sidekick. But Superman should smile more. I think that's a superpower. It's sort of like, you know, being president and waving and having a rainbow come out of your... Do you remember that picture? Obama's standing on the top of the stairs to the plane, and he's waving, and there's this rainbow behind him emitted from his fingertips. That's Superman's smile.
I agree with Elliot, I am correct.
Dean Cain does a lot of smiling, I just want to point that out.
Yeah,
another rip for the smile of Tyler, when his debut episode, when he saves that family from the killer drone, and then immediately turns and smiles at the kids, just like...
Right.
Complete antidote to Henry Cavill and Zack Snyder's misery. The thing that comes to mind as far as Silver Age goes, as far as Superman outwitting his opponents or using something other than his superpowers, is the titillating stories. Especially the best of them, because they put him against a guy who he's more powerful than he is, a real god in a sense, and he's forced time and again to outwit him. And it just makes him so much more relatable and so much more, you know, it forms so much more of a connection with the reader, because it's like, oh yeah, we don't have superpowers, but I bet if we, you know, study harder, or we, you know, use our wits, you know, we could defeat Mitchell's pivotal like that. So sorry, Paul Dini had to spend like an hour teaching how to say that name. But yeah, so the Mixie stories are, you know, I think the quintessentials, and the two best I'm gonna admit aren't even in the Silver Age. It's John Byrne's The Name Game, where Superman rearranges the keys in the giant typewriter that Mixel Piddle builds so that he spells his name backwards. And in Superman the animated series when Gilbert Godfrey does the definitive his first episode especially is just like corny cook. It's like vintage Looney Tune.
One of my favorites. As I would say.
Well, I mean, that's golden age. I mean, the pronunciation has changed, so it's...
that's true.
Mixopedalic, right? Then it's Mixius Pedalic?
That's what Mark Waid says.
Okay, the original spelling was Mixius Pedalic. Now it's Mixius Pedalic. I had this guy... can I tell
you? Absolutely, do it.
This guy was renting a room from me, and he was an actor in the Valley, and his name was Josh. And he said, come see my play. So I call my girlfriend and we go see this play, and it's a pretty good play. And at some point he refers, and he didn't, I hardly knew him at that point. And he, in play, he refers to Mixius Pedalic, and he pronounces it Mixius Pedalic, and which is the pronunciation that Mort Weisinger used to put in the letters column. And I said, I went up to him after the play, and I said, that was pretty good, but you know, you mispronounced Mixius Pedalic's name. He says, oh no, Julius Schwartz was my great uncle.
What?
I said, excuse me, no, Julius Schwartz was my great uncle. I said, and it turns out it was Julius' grandnephew. Didn't know that, but I corrected him, and I told him all these Julie stories. It was great.
That's awesome.
So my non-superpower example is virtually almost every single issue and every single episode in that Clark Kent is often the hero of these as a reporter. Let's give a big clap for journalism, because that's what these are about. It's about Clark Kent and promoting this and solving the issue of the day because of solid journalism. Superman comes in at the end to rescue them because they've been so effective at their jobs that the bad guys have kidnapped them and are about to chainsaw them or blow them up or usually drown them. But the primary thing is it's about solid journalism. With that said, the example I'm going to give is not that. It's from action number 12, where Superman decides that he's going to declare a war on reckless driving. And so he takes over a radio studio, barricades it, and then goes on the air and says, from this moment on, I declare war on reckless drivers. Henceforth, homicidal drivers answer to me. He then abducts the mayor and makes him drive fast through town so that thereafter the mayor will make the police enforce the speed limits in a way that they hadn't been doing before. That's without powers.
One of my favorite moments from Man of Steel is where we really get to see the vulnerability of the character, and it's something that really humanizes the character, is the great debate of if he should or shouldn't turn himself over to General Zod. He goes to the church, he seeks guidance, and he's really trying to figure it out, and I think that's a beautiful moment where we actually get to see Superman on his own, with a little bit of help, trying to figure out what the right thing to do is and how that outcome is going to affect what happens next. Because he can turn himself over, he can turn himself over to General Zod, and it could have the same outcome as it potentially could have if he doesn't turn himself over. And I think that's the biggest struggle that he has internally, is figuring out, if I do this, is this going to benefit humanity? Or am I going to cripple humanity and bring it to its knees? Because me giving myself up to General Zod is still going to mean that they'll destroy Earth. So I think, to me, that's a very pivotal internal moment for that character, of him really, of the movie really exploring the humanity of who he is, and trying to make it look more relatable to people who, frankly, a lot of people out there don't care about Superman because they think he's too overpowered. He's not relatable enough. And there are plenty of versions in previous history where he's done beautifully, whether it's movies, the shows, the comics. But I've talked to so many people, and they would say that there are specific moments in Man of Steel that just brought him closer to the audience because of little things like that, because we got to explore his psychology a little bit more. In terms of the smile, I feel like that character, to me at least, yes, he was a bit brooding, and he was a bit more emotional than we kind of recognized him to be, but he wasn't Superman. That last scene in Man of Steel where he shows up in the Daily Planet, and Lois says to him, "Welcome to the planet," and he just smiles at her. To me, that was the revelation of, like, Superman is here. This is Superman. The next movie will be Superman.
We have someone patiently waiting with a question. If there are any comments, I'm sure we'd love to hear them after the panel, but let's reserve some time, I guess, for questions. Yes?
Mine is just a statement. I'll be real quick. I know the fictional characters, they don't exist, but...
What?
You see what I'm saying? It's like, I don't want to... You know, BVS, it kind of broke my heart to see him get beat by Batman. I mean, I love Batman, but I'm just... Warner Brothers DC puts Batman up here and everybody else down here, and I'm just tired of it. And it just broke my... He shouldn't have lost like that. And I don't know if anybody mentioned All-Star Superman, but I think the best use, his non-powered use... I mean, I almost nearly cried at grown man's at the end when he saved little kids from cancer with the Kandorians. He said, "Tomorrow you're going to walk out of this hospital." I was like, damn. That's how far it gets down.